You know, as I come up here, you always can expect some fun things, right? Because too heavy duty. Okay, I try to make it as light as we can, but let's begin first. Let's begin right first, okay? We surrender, we yield ourselves to you. And we open our hearts. We ask, as just we worshiped, let your river of life inside of us be activated. Flow, flood every part of our being. To our ears, to our eyes, the eyes of our heart, the ears of our heart, of our spirit man. For without you, we don't hear, we don't see, we cannot understand, we cannot even speak. So we yield and we receive from you. By faith, the faith of the Son of God, not our own faith. And we thank you and praise you ahead of time for all that you are, Father. When you gave your Son, you offered him up for us all. How will you not with him also give us all things? So, brothers and sisters, I ask you, leave your mind behind. Leave your thoughts. Come down to your heart. And connect with the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Christ in you. So no longer you will hear with your mind. But you listen whatever the Lord wants to speak to you this morning with your heart. In Jesus' name, amen. So I'm going to just introduce a little bit about the Freedom Encounter for all of you guys who have not been in the Freedom Encounter. So let me see, how many of you have not gone through the Freedom Encounter? Would you raise your hand? All right, not too many. Okay. I want to first to talk about something very, very important to the Father's heart and to my heart. Let's look at Romans 8, 28, 29, and 30. This verse is so familiar to all of us. But let's look into the very, very essence that the Lord wants us to know and have. And that's the very essence of why we're here, why we're created. And we know that all things work good to those who love God, for those who are the called, according to his purpose. For whom he foreknew, he also predestined. I want to emphasize the word purpose. Let's look at what purpose means in the original language. Will you show that, please? Purpose, the Greek prophethos, it suggests a deliberate plan, a proposition, advanced plan, intention, and design. Design, intentionality, advanced plan, deliberation. That's what God, when he created you and I, he designed us, he has plans for us, he created us for a purpose, for a calling, for a destination, for identity. You and I, each one of us, are unique. Only you and I can accomplish, to finish the work, the calling, the purpose, the destiny God has for us. But you know what? As we look around, even look at ourselves, we know how many of us are struggling with this. We don't know our purpose. We don't know our identity. We don't know our calling. And that is what? That is frustration, isn't it? A sense of hopelessness and loss. Now, in the encounter, we are dealing with some of the issues. You can also look at, if you want to, for your reference, Ephesians 1:11, Ephesians 1:9, 2 Timothy 2 and 9. Because that's not, Romans 8 is not the only scripture. Let me just read it to you. Who hath saved us and what? Called us. Here, calling again, isn't it? With an holy calling, not according to our works, but according to what? His own purpose. And grace. To grace, the grace given to us to finish the purpose. Which was given us in who? Christ Jesus, before the foundation of the world. So in Psalm 139, it says that before even any one of us, our essence will be formed. What happened? Our life, our purpose, our calling were written in that book. Each one of us have that book. Now, then why we have such difficult time? Well, you know the answer. Satan, isn't it? John 10:10. The thief does not come except to steal, to kill, and to destroy. So what is he mainly stealing? Is our whole destiny, our whole purpose, our whole calling, our identity. Now, let's look at Satan's name, because from his name, we can understand what he does. Let's look at adversary. Adversary. Adversary came from the Greek word antidikos, two root words, anti and dikos. Anti means deny, oppose, dikos means right and justice, is legal terminology. So he's legalist. He is denying our right. Okay? So let's look at accuser. What does it mean? Accuser, kategoros. Two words, kategoros. What does it mean? A complainant at law in the court. So we have an adversary against us. But as we know, he doesn't have the right if we don't have open doors. If we don't have anything in us or on us that give him the legal right, isn't it? So therefore, in this encounter, we're dealing with many areas of these open doors, of these legal grounds. Now today, I'm going to focus on one thing, one area, which is the ungodly belief, the lies that we believe. Romans 12:2, let me read it to you. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed, that means metamorphosis, totally change from a worm to a butterfly. All right, now, by the what? By the renewing of your mind. Now, for many years, I did not know mind, this word. I thought just our thought life. not until I went into the Greek. Thank you, Pastor Steve. Encourage us to have that strong concordance in our cell phone. So I began just every time something really speak to me, loud, speak loud to me, I go to the original root. And you know what that means? Mind, the word Greek is nous. It includes not just thoughts. It includes our thoughts, include our emotions, feelings, and our will. Now look at that. Isn't that encompass the whole of us? The, our innermost being, the will, the emotions. We know scientifically they've proven that the enteric nervous system is in the gut, in the belly. And it's the second brain they discovered that is feeling the emotions. Tell your mind how to think and how to feel. Oh, so we have to transform not just the thoughts, but what has to do issues of the heart. Let me say again. It's not just the thoughts up here, because in the Greek influenced Western civilization, everything is a mind, isn't it? It's the thoughts up here. That's why I'm anticipating more and more of this coming conference, because it's all about the heart. So it's a heart issue. It's a wounding of our whole being that caused us to have these lies, ungodly beliefs. Okay. So what does a renew means? Renewing. Now, original Greek, it says renovation. So what is involved with renovation? First, to restore to a former, better state. I love that. Because when God created us, as Larry Napier will say, is the right brain is the lion genius. Huh? Former, better state. When God created us, Adam and Eve, the mind was brilliant. Now we're only using 2 to 5%. So renewing, to restore to former better state, as by what? Cleaning, repairing, rebuilding. That talk about what we need to do with our ungodly belief, isn't it? We need to clean up the old, the lies. We need to repair the damages that in our heart, in our life, the woundedness, and we need what? To rebuild. So when you really look deep into the scripture, it speaks a lot, isn't it? God began to give us new revelations. And I think this is the way we should go, is that we need to take the word of God, really go into the spirit, into our heart. Allow God to speak to us. Because then when you give time to God, when you open your heart, you yield to God, what happens? You will encounter the living Christ inside of you. The revealer begin to speak to you. The things you never thought about before, he will begin to speak. The Holy Spirit that dwells in us, he will bring other things just like that. Other scriptures, he give you understanding. So I'm off the track, but let's get back to this. So let me open this one now, okay? Let's see. So that was the introduction. So in other words, the reason why we have not been transformed is because we have not been renewing our nous. We have not been renewing what? Our will, our emotions, and our thoughts. So let's say, where did these lies come from? Where did ungodly belief come from? Do you know the answer? Can you give me an answer? Where? Exactly. Satan. The kindergarten was the devil, right? Everything started from Genesis, isn't it? Genesis 3. So what's Satan's name? Again, father of lie. So Adam and Eve heard God's word, God's commandment, and Satan comes, put the thoughts in Adam and Eve. Did God really say it? Because God really knows if you eat that fruit, you'll be as smart as God. Your eyes will be opened and you will not die. Quite the opposite, isn't it? After we ate the fruit, we died. We already were like God because he created us in his image and likeness. But see how Satan began to have the ungodly belief. And what happened when you eat ungodly belief? What you believe when you eat it? Death. And that's what Satan does. One time the Lord showed me, he said, the devil, if I were the devil, I just put a little bit lie at the very young age. I just can't. The lie that little boy, little girl, or even in the womb believe, they will destroy themselves. That how poisonous, how deathly ungodly belief is. So first, come from Satan. Second, come from our wounding, hurt, traumas. Can as early as in the womb. Now, ungodly beliefs, since start so early, we're so used to it. We live in that lies. We don't even know we live in lies, isn't it? Because it's just part of us. And we feel very comfortable with it. Lies and wounding are like Siamese twins. Now, pretend, Bamban, can you come over? So here is where Siamese twins. We become more and more alike, don't we? Huh? So this is a lie. That's hurt. When you know there is a lie, behind it, there's a wounding. Okay, so we go like this, all our lives together, never apart, never be apart, unless something is done, something happens, okay? Now, they become mental stronghold. And that's why I want to talk about this, because we know many of us no longer struggle, okay, many of us no longer struggle outwardly with so-called sins, but we struggle here, up here, isn't it? Okay. Now, I want to show the iceberg. Can you show the iceberg, Kim? Thank you. Yes. You see the iceberg on top is the tip of the iceberg. That's our conscious mind. But the majority underneath the surface, more than 95% is in our subconscious. they're saying scientifically they're proven. The conscious mind processes 2,000 bits of information per second. That's our conscious mind. Now listen to this one. Subconscious mind, subconsciousness, I would say, process, listen to this, 400 billion bits of information per second. That's more than 95%, don't you say? So when the scripture says our heart is extremely wicked, who will know it? Now, you say, well, I used to say, my heart is not wicked. Lord, you know that. But who really knows our subconscious? Who really knows? Isn't it? We ourselves don't know. Other people don't know. Holy Spirit is the one. He's the one who searched the heart and know us. And so when we don't know really ourselves, but we see the bondages in our lives. For example, you know, Pastor Steve been talking about getting into heaven, getting into the presence of God. But I have to tell you this, many people come to us to receive ministry, even pastors, ministers. They come is because they're so tormented. They cannot get close to God. They cannot get intimacy. They don't know what love is. They don't know what the presence of God is. They cannot hear God. They cannot see God. There are some things inside deep that is blocking the intimacy, isn't it? Because I have so many notes, I need to skip. So, what are the results of the ungodly beliefs? What are they, the results? What are they, how they influence affecting us? Can I know the time because I cannot see the clock? All the left, okay, let me see.
It's 10 o'clock.
10 o'clock, okay.
20 minutes.
20 minutes, okay. If I have grace, I can have a little more. Okay, all right. Let me move fast. I asked the Lord to stretch the time this morning. Okay. Okay. So what it does, I see, oh, it's so dark out there, you know? I can't see anything. I can see the Larry. You're dirty. Your face is so dirty. Oh, man, I can see that. Oh, wow, somebody else. You need to take a bath there. Okay. Oh, that person, you're just full of shame there. No, you're critical. No. So through this ungodly belief pair of glasses, everything I perceived are thwarted. Now I can see. Yeah, now I can see. So it twists our perception. Okay? Twist of perception. I'll give you an example, okay? So they call belief expectation cycle, okay? So in the past, I've experienced that my father always abused me verbally, physically, okay? So what my belief is that, well, men are dangerous, they're abusive. And so when I get older, I start dating, and I have relationships just about we're engaged, then I just back out. Because the subconscious ungodly believes that all men are abusive, it's dangerous. Okay? So what happened, the behavior is I withdraw, I back out. Do you see that? It is a vicious cycle. And then you continue to say, okay, then you don't know that you yourself back out, self-sabotage. You just think, oh, it didn't work out. you go from relationship to relationship to relationship, think something's wrong with me. Okay? So it affects how we see things. Now let's talk about how does ungodly belief accept us, ourselves. Recently, we've been studying a book, and that's a really wonderful book. One of the things they were saying that science has this has been probably going on for a while, just I don't know about it. We have in our cells, every cell has many receptors. That means little open doors. And we have identity receptors. So whatever environmentally we receive from childhood, from out there, what people say about us, when we're heard, when we lie, talk about us, when we're cursed, our receptor receive them and write history on ourselves and create what? False identity. Do you see what I'm talking about? So, I need Steve again. Steve? Yeah. So remember we talk about when God created us, we are what? So awesome, wasn't it? Our true identity. Just like God, full of glory and honor, purpose, no sin, nothing. The minute we enter our mother's womb, whoa, the very moment of conception, the generational iniquity in the bloodline begin to contaminate us. And that's just the beginning. In the womb, we receive rejection, And through our childhood, through our school years, through our adult life, guess what? So all these things are recorded in our identity cells, receptors. So, okay, you can put it on. Okay, so let's just do it, right? All these things are... pretty soon, so covered up, we don't see the real Steve anymore. And people look at him, that's his fake identity, and he sees himself fake identity. So many times what happens, I forgot the mask. So also what? We begin to wear masks. We begin to what? Become what? Superwoman. A nerd. A millionaire. All right? A brilliant psychiatrist. All that covers up to hide. That's our false identity. Thank you. So, what happened? Satan stole our true identity, isn't it? Now, we all know that many of us have heard our parents say, you're stupid, isn't it? You're stupid. Everything you touch fail. You never amount to anything. You know what? We receive that lie. We believe that as a little kid. We don't know the truth. We really believe. I know many brilliant, high IQ people. They think they're stupid. They don't even dare go beyond high school. They don't dare to do anything in the kingdom of God because they think they're just failure. They're such failure, such a loser. God doesn't really want to use him in the kingdom. There you go. Your purpose, your identity, your destiny, your calling, stolen. So let's... Kim, have that thought, believe, action, destiny thing. Okay, can you see that? Now, first you say, oh, I have a lie. How can my destiny be stolen? Look at how it does. You have a thought planted in you that become your ungodly belief. Your actions, behavior shows it, and that become a habit, and the build into a character, and result your destiny. Do you see that? With others, how it affect others. Because of the ungodly belief, many of us, because of wounding, will build up walls of self-protection. So I hear this complaint all the time from wives. My husband doesn't speak to me. All the emotions he can show is anger. And I hear a husband say, but I have this thing inside. I don't know how to express it. You know what? You go back, ask Jesus to take you back. Because somewhere, somehow, you're so hurt, you decided subconsciously, okay? You build a wall so that I can survive. I don't get hurt again. And that wall you build as childhood, as protection, when you grow older, it stops you from receiving love and give love, from hearing God's voice, from receiving God's love, intimacy, and giving love to God and to those who love. With God, how ungodly belief affect our relationship with God? Big deal, big. This is the most important thing I want to emphasize. As we know, many of us, Steve always say, well, just about over 95% of the people that come were hurt by their fathers. He jokingly say, well, let's just get rid of the fathers. Then we'll be no hurt, right? Well, our fathers, we have the experience of fathers, we project Father God as a father. For many, many years, because my father died, there was abandonment issue. But that's subconscious. I didn't feel I was abandoned. But I struggled for many, many years of trusting. And God always, always come back to me and say, trust me, Shirley. Don't you know that I love you? What we believe the lies affect big, greatly, our relationship with Father God. If your father is perfectionist, your projection of Father God is that he is perfectionist. He wants you to be perfect. You got to do, and not enough. If your father is a violent, abusive, subconsciously you always have this fear of God, this unhealthy fear of God. They will do something wrong that something bad is going to happen to me. Emotionally, these ungodly beliefs give us all these emotional issues of fears, depression, anxiety, low self-worth, nightmares, insomnia, all the stuff. I'm not even telling you all the stuff because it's a long list. But how does that affect physically? They say statistically 87% of sicknesses related to our mindset. Now, fears created 1,400 chemicals and 30-plus different types of hormones in our body. Every thought creates 400 billion electrical and magnetic responses, thus affect our immune system. Negative thoughts destroy our T cells, thus resulting in diseases. There was Reader Digest research. They did 2,800 people their answers. They ask the question, do you feel your health is excellent, normal, or poor? Among the people who answered their health is excellent, compared with those people, they answer, my health is poor. This group lives 4 years longer than this group, even though at the beginning, physically, they're the same. Okay, I think I don't have too much time, so I'm just going to jump. Now, the important part is when we receive ungodly belief, that means in spiritual realm, we made an agreement, we made a covenant with the enemy. Okay? That's how serious it is. Just look at Adam and Eve, isn't it? So, we need to deal with, even when we do the renunciation of our sins, we need to be sure to break ungodly ties, ungodly covenant, break with the devil, okay? So let me jump around because I want to come to very important things. So, as we said before, if you just work on your mind, your thoughts, okay, up here. You tried, okay, okay, this is my ungodly belief, and this is God's truth. I'm going to just recite, declare God's truth, okay? For example, I am stupid. No, God says, I created you like me, you're in my image, you're smart, you're wise. We can do that until we turn blue. It doesn't work. If only up here. It really has to touch the root. All right, upside down. So if you just pick the root, you say, okay, Lord, I repent, renounce that one. And I say, this is your truth. Why it doesn't work? Because you have not gone to the root of that ungodly belief. Now, come back again. Only the Holy Spirit knows our subconscious. We pray the prayer, Psalm 139, 23, 24. God, search me, know my heart, and see if there are any fearful thoughts and hurtful way in me. And I added one more thing. Lord, I even give you access deep to my subconscious. Search there. Only you know. So ask the Lord to take you back to the root of this lie. And when you ask the Lord, he does come. Why? Why he does come? Because he's in waiting to heal you. That's what he died for. That's what he came to earth for, is to set you free. Of course he will answer you if you do with your heart. If you give him, if you yield, surrender, let him search deep to your subconscious. So you pray the prayer to humble yourself first and open yourself up and ask the Lord to show you. Now, can you show the 5 F's, please? I'm jumping around. Okay, so here, okay? Now, the Clarks make it very simple, 5 F's. So as you ask the Lord, ask him to show you, and he will make something surface to your awareness, either the first person, either a person first shows up, or idea, or feeling, or memory, okay? Then allow yourself to feel the gut feeling, the true feeling. When that person shows up, how do you feel? Are you angry? Do you feel rejected? All right? After those feelings, then the third step is forgive. Now, many times when we forgive with our up here, it doesn't work. Matthew 18, toward the end, Jesus said, you have to forgive with your heart. Everything comes to the heart, isn't it? So, forgive. How do we deal with forgiveness? And if you want to know, come to the encounter. There's a right way to forgive, there's a wrong way to forgive. The right way to forgive is thorough, is quick, is miraculous. Okay, come and find out. Then ask God about, we put F, but actually it's truth. You ask God, okay, what is the truth, Lord? And he will speak to you. And even in that moment, he will make you to encounter with him. He begin to show up. He begin to minister to you with his truth. And then, after that, you ask the Lord to fill you with the truth. To fill you with a love that you were missing in your life because of the wounding. So, right now, it's 10:20. I was going to do ministry with you guys, but I don't think I have time. Finish with the prayer? Okay. Now, there are two kinds of thoughts come. One is the old, repeated, and is internal. That you need to go through the five steps. The second one that come to us from outside, and that's distracting thoughts, is now thoughts. The devil come to tempt us. Once you deal with the root issue and the devil come tempt you again, what happens? You want to say no. James 4:7. No to the devil. Don't engage with him. Don't fight with him. You yield, submit to God. That means you're yielding yourself, open yourself, get down to the river, and let Christ in you to forgive, to resist, to fight. That's what it means, James 4:7. Submit to God. Say no to the devil, and he will flee from you. So, Pastor Steve, you want me to pray? Okay. So now, I want you to close your eyes, okay? Now leave your head behind. Come down to your heart. Just tell the Lord, search me, Lord. And see if there's any fears, any hurt in me. I give you access even to the subconscious. Will you show me? Open your heart. Let Christ in you to reveal to you. Is there anything fear, any hurt? Now, first come to your awareness. Is it a person? Is it a memory? Is it a feeling? Now, feel the feeling in your gut. It will help for you to put your hand on your gut. Just see how you feel. Now, whatever those negative feelings come up, I want you to release them into the river of life in you. That's the Holy Spirit. Just release it. Release your fears. Let it go into the river. Is it anxiety? Is it anger? Is it shame? No, just go ahead, release and let go into the river. Now receive Christ's forgiveness. Receive that river of forgiveness inside of you. Say, Lord, I receive your river of forgiveness. Will you flow to these negative emotions? Flow to and through them. Wash, cleanse, and carry away. I receive your river of healing love. Flow to those places of my brokenness and hurt. Heal, Lord, with your river of love. Now, if it's you cannot forgive yourself, just say, Lord, I receive your forgiveness. I forgive myself. Now, do this until you have that perfect peace, shalom, the Prince of Peace, rule in your heart. Now, ask the Lord Jesus to release his river of forgiveness to the person who hurt you. Let Christ in you, the forgiver, to forgive that person. No longer I live, but Christ lives within me. No longer I forgive, but Christ in me forgive. Now ask the Lord, Lord, what is the truth you want to tell me? Let the Lord minister to you. Lord Jesus, I ask you, take everyone that's been in bondage, in prison of these lies and hurts. Will you take them out of the prison? I ask you, lock those doors behind and take each person up, 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 ascend into your third heaven, to your throne room. And I ask you to restore everything the enemy has stolen, especially their identity, their calling, their destiny. Restore, Lord. Minister to each of your precious children. Just open your heart, receive.
Really encourage everyone to consider coming to the Freedom Encounter in a few weeks, and Steve and Shirley will be over at the back in Tom to answer any questions or register anyone, and we're going to have a great week. We're going to start prayer in about 2 minutes for the nations, and we'd love for you to stay with us as we just kind of reign with Christ for a moment and call this week to be a glorious week of inauguration of the Son of God, kissing the Son. So God bless you. Do you have something?
Ask them, if you are still ministering by the Lord right now, do not rush it. Just be quiet and continue to receive. It's very important, okay? Don't break that.
Yes, Mama. All right. God bless. We're going to start praying in 2 minutes.